It goes like this. For those of you who like to sing, you're going to sing. And for those of you who don't like to sing, you're going to sing. So, hills and their glorious heights surround us by day and by night. Sing praise to the hills. Sing praise to the hills. The hills and their glorious heights surround us by day and by night. Sing praise to the hills. Sing praise to the hills. The hills and their glorious heights surround us by day and by night. Sing praise to the hills. Sing praise to the hills.
Experiment. Now watch me. One section, two section, three section. One section.
The hills and their glorious.
The hills and their glorious.
The hills and their glorious.
Surround us by day and by night.
Surround us by day and by night.
Conversation about land narratives, and we're going to change the format a little here, and I'm going to start in smaller groups. So I'm going to offer a couple things first, and then we're gonna do some sharing. Number one, if you can, be conscious of speaking your voice forward. If you're able, some people are having a hard time hearing in there, and also for the recordings for HowlRound. So if we could all get used to using the outside voice, that would be great. Yeah. Thank you for the people who just offered all the beautiful thinking, and that was really incredible. So, acknowledgement to that. We have some beautiful folks who we invited to be part of this land narrative conversation. And what we're going to do is we're going to break into some smaller groups right now. The folks who were invited to speak to how the land inspires their work and how they incorporate the land into their work are going to do that with you in a smaller context. And then we are going to all participate in a story circle whereby everyone in the group will get a chance to tell a story of their own about the land, hopefully inspired by what that person prompted for you when they're sharing. That'll be the first section. Then we'll come back together as a large group and report back from those story circles. The people who will report back are the folks who are invited to present about their land and their work. And it'll also be an opportunity at the end to have a little bit of a dialogue with those folks, teasing out some of the perspectives that they have. Cool? So I want to lean into two things. One, who are people here who have experienced a story circle? Good. So I'm going to ask that the collective knowledge in the room really help out those smaller circles for people who haven't participated. But I just want to say, before we break into the smaller groups, story circles are technology that I learned from our great friend and teacher, John O'Neill. Many people use it. It was a means that John was using it in his theater work, and the Free Southern Theater and SNCC were using it in their work organizing to hear the perspectives of people and to hear the stories that they had and allow those stories to collectively envision the art they wanted to make. It's a very simple technology whereby you sit in a circle, everyone has a chance to tell a story based upon a prompt. You start, the stories are timed, so there will be a timekeeper in every group. Today, I'll tell you the time once I look at the time and we break into the groups. Let's say it's 3 minutes a person. That person tells a story. The person next to them can either tell a story or pass. Silence is a story, so you can allow that to be. You go around the whole group. Some of the guidelines we think about is when in doubt, tell the story that comes from the deepest place. It's a process of active listening, so there's no journaling or typing. You're just sitting there, being present with the story as it is composed, in the ears, as John would say. Once everyone goes around the circle, then there will be a period of what we call crosstalk, whereby you can ask questions of people, talk to them about what they said, etc. Those are some simple guidelines that I know anybody else want to add any to the circle before we break about the story circle. Yep?
Just that you're participating by listening. That's the most active way to participate. Only one person signed, so everybody's participating.
By listening. Cool. Can I have the people stand as you are able that are were invited to be part of the land narrative discussion? Can we just see you all? So there's one and two and three and four and five and six and seven, and I will be eight. So I'm going to go around and we're going to count off in eights. Carrie will be the ones, Chantal will be the twos, Matt will be the threes, Chip will be the fours, the fives, Bobby B, the six, Monique, Renan, the seven, Nick Sly, and then I said there was
eight.
Kita. You were backed up. And the eights will be Kita. So let's go starting with Carlos. You're up.
One,
two, three, four,
five,
six, seven, eight.
One,
two, three, four,
five,
six, seven, eight.
One,
two, three, four, five,
six, seven,
eight.
One,
two.
Oh, I'm four.
No,
I'm sorry. You're
three.
Three. Yeah, three.
Four,
five,
six,
seven,
eight.
One,
two,
three,
four,
five.
Six, seven.
Six and seven. Anybody else?
Eight.
Eight, legit. One more time.
One.
Ones, right here.
Two.
The twos. The threes with Matt. Fours with Chip. Five with Bobby B. Six with Monique. Seven with myself. And eight with Kita. This is how I'd like you to do it. I'd like us to try to do it in silence, if we can. Just quietly pick up your chair and... let's make a little group over here. Let's make another group over there. Let's go to this circle that was set up intuitively for us by the double-edged people. And let's have three groups in here. That's good. So, yeah, just pick up your chair and follow your leader. Thank you.
I'll follow the sound.
All right, folks who are leaders of the groups, you're on the clock for five to share your a little about your work, your relationship to land. So you're on the clock right now for five. You kick it off to the group. Share the little bit of narrative we talked about, and then I'll come back and tell you when we'll start the story circle, all right? So go ahead. Yes.
So my name is Matt McCarty. I'm an artist, writer. I direct an organization called Art of the Rural. I started it 6 years ago as a blog. To look at contemporary rural arts and culture. I was writing a PhD at the time and very frustrated with the process. And it was my way out to have a connection and feel that the things I was thinking about had some sort of bearing on the life around me. I'm also a member of a group called N12. We could be called an art collective. We kind of call ourselves a studio. We do a lot of artwork. We're getting into the isms here, but like post studio work that doesn't fit in a gallery, that's outside in the community, it's in a landscape. It's in some sort of site beyond like official institutional structures. I'm actually leaving here to go to Des Moines. We're working on a project at the Iowa State Fair in a horse stall. So it's kind of a sense of kind of what we do. and where we work, and we're really focused on the actual culture of rural communities right now, whether it's agriculture or moving beyond that, what it's like to live in sort of communities of transition, a lot of rural communities are. I am from Appalachian, Ohio. I grew up on a farm. My family's been in one town for about five generations on one piece of land. My family lost their farm during the farm crisis. We still have the farm. It was kind of our family was living on. My brother is an organic farmer now there. But that experience, I think, kind of is why I'm here and why I do this work. And that early on, it was like a feeling of knowing that there was some kind of land-based heritage, which was part of my history, but sort of feeling dissociated from it, displaced from it, because we traveled all over after we lost our farm. And I think, like, as this relates, there are, like, were so many amazing questions in what Nick and Matt wrote for this. What I think about a lot with this question of like land narratives is the context, and then what we see in terms of the reality in rural America versus the perception of it. So the context that we have in rural places, and I think this is, to some degree, I mean, it makes it all the more remarkable what's happening here at Double Edge. Rural America is 20-25% of our population. It receives 3% of American philanthropy every year.
How much?
So 3%. So that's a loss per capita of $28 billion a year. There are other sort of federal blind spots in terms of how rural communities can be supported versus urban ones. There are 15 different federal definitions of rural. So rural essentially is this large, it isn't even misunderstood, it's talked about in so many different ways, and sort of largely, deeply underserved and in an unequal position to the systems of power, while also sort of suffering population change and out-migration, while at the same time, the last sort of rollout of census data tells us that 83% of population growth in rural America is people of color. And we like, and I say that because we have a lot of like easy go-to images and assumptions about what rural culture is, what it looks like. You know, it's, we're going to see them all for like the next 3 months in the presidential campaign. You know, Trump is going to be in front of a barn talking about making America great again. You know, that kind of thing. It's very sentimental. The reality of those communities is often very different. And I think, sensing that I have like 45 seconds left, what I think about a lot in all of this work, and I think it pertains to these awesome questions that they originally asked us to think about, is that like it's a place that's like radically in transition. And I think so many of the projects that would be included in this larger conversation from a rural space, or I think that they really bring that to life. You know, like a lot of roots work, Double Edge, M12, Worm Farm. Like it is a space of radical transformation. Like what I think about the moment where this was sort of brought home to me was a drive that I took through. You guys have been to like North Central Iowa, Mason City.
Yep.
Yeah, so I live in Minnesota right now. I live in Winona, Minnesota. And you can't drive through that area or through north central Illinois. I love that landscape and the culture there. You know, and not feel that it's an area that we don't really talk a lot about, but the signs of transition are sort of everywhere. You know, economically, you know, these are communities that are getting smaller as the scale of agriculture gets larger. You know, and that's not because of the desires of those people in these rural communities, it's because of the desires of like urban consumers. And that's ever since commodity agriculture was opened up globally, that's sort of what has happened in the last 200 years. But all of that is happening at the same time as many of these communities in rural Iowa and in Illinois are becoming, in some cases, like radically diverse really quickly. So you have not only that transition, but you have a social and cultural transition and an economic gap where these communities are already looking very different. They're grappling with their own history, often in very contentious ways. And economically, we're going to have a space where there is not going to be a middle class in those towns. So I mean, I'm totally not even talking about my own work. I mean, that's the question to me, to some degree, is like that's the level of the challenge that we have as artists or as people talking about it. You know, is that how do we come together to talk about that? How do we share those stories? And how do we begin, since America is so large, how do we begin to comparatively learn from each other about very different regions and rural experiences? I veered so far from like talking. I mean, I could talk about like what we do at Art of the Rural. I mean, like we're interested in exchange, human to human exchange, in particular across rural and urban space, which is something I could talk a lot more about. We look a lot at thinking about creative placemaking is a word that is everywhere right now. How do you do that in a culturally responsible way in rural America? We don't have the language for that yet. We don't have the support structures for it. We're hoping to help facilitate that with lots of other people. And lastly, like our other major initiative is looking at the Mississippi River. And about that as a continuum instead of sort of a series of communities or a series of siloed ways of talking about the river. How do we bring folks together across disciplines, you know, economy, culture, history, to talk about those spaces, and how do we bring those communities together? So many of them, whether we're talking about Hannibal, you know, West Helena, Winona, Itasca, are thinking through similar issues just in different geographic spaces. That's a little bit about my story. I guess there wasn't a 5-minute film, so I'm just going to assume that it was 5 minutes.
Curiosity and being open to working with people who wanted to really tell the story. And in that, this healing process of like, we have our water comes into our
so
I have a question about your work. It's, what does it mean for Art of the Rural to be like happening in a city? Right, that like you're not headquartered in a rural place.
You know, this gets to like one of, and this is kind of within my own story, is that I'm really interested in how we can talk about rural as a cultural designation. I mean, I might talk about, like I come to all this as well from like Irish studies.
Irish studies,
yeah, no, it's crazy, like, river, like, you know, I'm a creative writer, and I come out of, like, looking like Irish cultural studies, that's kind of where I really began to think about Appalachia and rural America was actually living in County Donegal, Ireland for a while, you know, and Irish identity in America is super fluid, and people actually claim it and exercise it in certain kind of ways. I mean, unfortunately, on one day of the year for the most part, but it's there as a conversation. And we don't really have that to any vigorous degree with the notion of rural, although all of that is much more accessible to us than, you know, my own Irish great-great-grandparents in Donegal or something. But I think within that, you know, if we look at like the 20th century as a real century of migration, cheers. Thanks. Can I continue that later?
Yep, sure.
Cheers. So, did Nick? Do I kick it off and then you go around?
Yeah.
How does land.
We have crossroads summer.
Nick, how much time?
How is it informing or how are you responding?
It is 12:24.
3-minute stories. Everyone gets 3.
I think we can start however we want.
Sorry?
We can start however we want.
How does land influence or are you responsible?
In any kind of physical land and anywhere. And so, in a sense, like you were saying, I carry it wherever I am, like a nomad. And I don't expect to ever actually find a place where I root myself into a territory that's like. And so in a way, there it's opportunistic, like a nomad, going where temporarily, wherever I get fed.
We lost our farm, so I have a lot of artists.
I guess I'll start where I'm from. That may help me. I'm from Manhattan, New York, and I've lived there for 20 years now. And I think whilst being there, it's such a bustling city, and I've had all the options at my fingertips, that I kind of feel the need to hold myself all the time. I feel the need to hold so much information in my mind and all my feelings in my heart, because if I show any of that on the street, it's kind of fatal. And so I have to walk and hold myself in a way where I know where I'm going and I know who I'm going to see, and I can't back down, otherwise I'll fall apart. And actually right before I got to this theater farm,
it was like that for a long time, and there was that place was in the front hope.
And all they needed was a frame to help make that happen. And we all did that with no money, so it was purely like wanting to do it. And then we engaged all these people, and it was. I wish there had been a way to sort of measure how, you know, what the impact of that, and I that's something I would like to do in the future. But it was another way, and the people were invited to include local playwrights too, so their local sensibility was represented, and the way people organized their events was also very local. Like, for instance, Perseverance Theater in Alaska did a reading, a site-specific reading, at the foot of the glacier. So they really used what was around there, their own resources, to create something that would speak specifically to their people. So even though, I think that's another way where the conversation between the local and the global can be successful, because we provided something that was kind of from all over, and then we said, please, you know, add whatever you want, so you can have both conversation, and you can, and what you do can be really rooted in the community you're trying to serve. Yeah. Now I'm done. I feel like that's 5 minutes. Do you have, I think we can keep talking. Do you have any questions for me, or do you want to comment?
Have you been connected to Allison Carey?
Yes, yes. I'm part of this A2A.
Yeah.
Oh, cool. She's awesome.
Well, it's just exciting to hear the work that you're doing and the intersection of the things that she's doing as well.
Right.
And I'm. Is there an online space to learn more about the project you were just telling us about that was with multiple communities, 25 countries?
Yeah, it's on my personal website right now. Eventually it will live separately, but if you look my name, you'll find it. It's called, the tab is CCTA, Climate Change Theater Action.
Yeah. What do you find in the most successful ways of researching all these Arctic countries as you're writing the work about them? What are you doing?
I go. I make sure to go and to talk to people who live there. And then I do research. I do some research beforehand too. I talk to scientists. I try to talk to people as diverse as possible, so I don't have just one point of entry. And usually, actually, the first play I started with an idea, and I got completely thrown out the window. And then this most recent play, I had a vague idea, and this one I think I'm going to be able to pursue, so it varies. And then I don't know ahead of time what the next play will be, because I just follow the opportunity. So once I have a chance to go somewhere, you know, it's in my head, I know what the eight countries are, so when I see, you know, residencies or fellowships or something, I'm like, okay, this is going to be, if I get that one, it's going to be the next one.
Have you found an intersection in your creative work with other, like, civic institutions or civic work around climate change?
I haven't been able to create any lasting relationships, and that has partly to do with the fact that I don't self-produce. So once I've developed the play, it goes to a theater in a community that I don't know. So I try to encourage them to partner, and the most that we've had is post-show conversations or
even pre-show conversations with local organizations. And I'm still trying to figure out how I can do more given those circumstances, and I haven't quite figured it out. So that's a tricky one. And I feel like the engagement needs to happen over time too, that, you know, if you give people information once for half an hour after a show, it might not be enough, but if there was some kind of, you know, if they want to self-organize or something, or if they have information over time, it might be more useful, but I'm not quite sure how to do that yet.
Seems like I'm just thinking of the big environmental organizations, Environmental Defense Fund, NRDC, Natural Resources Defense Council. I don't know what their primary goals are, but climate change must be one. But it's what an opportunity for them to engage you, to be part of their marketing story, you know, outreach, messaging.
Right. I've presented at scientific conferences, which one of the most successful ones, they used excerpts of one of my plays as the keynote for the conference, and then they extracted themes from that, and those became the talks after. So that was a really great merge, and it set the tone for conversation that was a little bit more open than just straight science.
Yeah.
And I like bridging those communities also.
Yeah. Probably open a pathway for different kinds of conversations.
Hopefully it can bring the focus to a little bit more humanistic. Conferences can focus a lot on like research facts and numbers as opposed to culture that get changed because of
Change. Yeah, and sometimes it just provides a slightly different understanding. Like, we presented a play at Kansas State University this past February, and people from the sciences told my friend who directed the play, who lives there and teaches there, they said to her, "You've just said in 2 hours what we're trying to teach her, what it takes a year to teach our kids." You know, so it's like, how do the facts apply to real life? Like, how do the facts affect us and emotionally, you know, and our values and our behavior, as opposed to just these are the numbers and this is what we need to do practically.
The result of being disassociated. So you're here, you're learning, and you have to go back and reassociate yourself. You're separated from the land, living in New York, which is originally called Manhattan. And there are very few places in New York where you can feel the ground. And for both of you, being separated from where you actually might feel more comfortable, because there are relationships there that transcend land, but you're here now, and this is your land. So I guess the question for me is, I think, and Brazil, Sao Paulo is horrendous. I live up here, and Aquino has its own problems, but Sao Paulo, yes, is total. I can't even describe it. It's amazingly awful. Surrounded by amazing beauty. Is this relationship more shaped by our discomfort or by our disassociation? You know, I, as a person who is separated from my land, I feel that has shaped me significantly. But for those, you know, is that what's shaping?
I think for a lot of us here, it's capitalism and colonialism that have shaped our relationships to land. And even the idea of this is indigenous land is in reaction to it being a colonized land.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact that my parents were immigrants was the kind of avenues that capitalism opened up for them. And their people had been within probably a 20-kilometer radius for about 2,000 years. And yeah, so that I think that's a common thread in our relationship to land.
Also, I think something that really puzzles me coming here, and especially to this place, which is a farm and which is isolated in a way from the world, is the fact that to me this is not isolation. Like, my dad owns a farm in Brazil, and there are no roads, there are no paved roads, there are dirt roads that people cart, and there's definitely not phone service or Wi-Fi or anything, and people that live around that area really have no access to a supermarket or anything, just recently, like in the past 5 years. But you couldn't ride cars, like you definitely couldn't ride cars, and I think here there is a false sense of isolation because, and maybe it has to do with colonialism and also the advance of technology for sure, but just the fact that we can get to here or even talk to people here, and the government knows that this exists, you know, it's, I think it's also a disconnection from what, like, the primitive idea of land means, to me at least. And I don't know what, I don't know how to revert that, or like how to get that, that sense of connection without, like, these lights, like, I look at these lights and it's like technology, or like phones or Hannah. and it's more of a question, I guess.
I think it's, there's a certain constancy about land, and at the same time, a certain more constant morphing about the thought of land. I think for the first few years when I came here as a student, you know, home was, you know, as long as my mother was alive, I just lost my mother last year, as long, you know, home was where the parents were, you know. Yes, we are working here, we are doing all this, but then you go home in December. But then, you know, but then when Ma passed, you know, then, you know, it really shifted. But then what is home? And, it really shifted, and then we realized that, you know, it's like my friend in Minneapolis, he's been here for 40 years, but he will not buy a snowblower because then he's deciding that he'll stay there. He's been there for 40 that. Years. What is the turning point of Darwin? So, you know, but really that was to me a turning point where we realize that, you know, we just have to acknowledge that we are in at least over 25 years. And so instead of having this nostalgia of, you know, that friends are there, my friends over there are real friends, and over here is just associates, and, you know, that really, that sort of artificial, you know, nostalgia shifted to an intentional acknowledging and building community. So it has affected me in a way that we are to accept that this is home now, and that is also home, and we have to build this. We have to build community here, which was always happening, I guess, but never really said that this is. We have to build with intention community here, because then mind shift of being a visitor to belonging. For a long time, never felt that, you know, belonging for various reasons. But I think we arrived at a place now in our career. It's about, it's really an inner search, and you arrive at a place where we are not shaped by others' acceptance or rejections or definitions, but it's a place of arrival. So then, with that consciousness of the land, then we build community. Much more intentionally now than when in my head I was a visitor. Yeah. It's all in the head. Nobody's telling me not to before, but at present that's what I feel.
I'm reflecting on that and how my family is spread all over the country, and so where is home? for, you know, and for me it will always be Montauk, but I don't live there. And how many of us don't live where we're from? And that discomfort again in building community, you know, over, it's the two of us and our son, and we've never lived in a place where we have a large number of family, so we have to build community and attach ourselves. But at the same time, neither my husband nor I ever intend to be buried in Boston. But we haven't decided where that next place is. So we're essentially becoming nomadic, building intentional community for a long span of time, and then intentionally uprooting ourselves and moving someplace else. And so what does that mean? We were in Michigan for 15 years, and then we moved to Boston, and now we have been in Boston for 16 years. So, and now we're going to have, you know, we have one more year, and then we have a son who's graduating from college, and where are we going to go after that? And where, what is our relationship to that community going to be in that land going to be?
I don't know if it has anything to do with my age, but I don't know, at this point in my life, I just feel like I'm floating a lot, because it's, I don't want to go back home, and I don't know where I'm going, but it's like I have this draw to build a community for myself, and I have no idea how to
The poverty rate is like 2 to 3 times the national average. The teen suicide rate is 2 to 3 times the national average, and people are dealing with issues of self-esteem, you know? And so it's important to me as a physician to, I'm working in the clinic, you know, to attempt to create an environment of wellness so people can realize their aspirations. But with this project in the community, I'm also trying to put a positive vibe out, you know, and create an environment of wellness. And yeah, so that particular image, yeah.
Yeah, it's interesting how the image of the image becomes another story.
Yeah, right.
Can I see
you? Yeah, yeah.
You're hiding it.
Yeah.
Yeah, what is the relationship between the Navajo Nation and the land currently?
Yeah. Okay, so in talking about the Navajo people, it's like, I guess, talking about any community, you're not talking about a monolithic group. Within the culture, there are the traditionalists, there are Christians, and then there's another religion that's practiced called the Native American Church. But the Native American Church and the traditionalists have a land-based religion. The traditionalists will wake up in the morning and greet the rising sun with corn pollen. And they say a prayer: with beauty above me, with beauty below me, with beauty all around me, may I walk in beauty. And it's that acknowledgement of basically leaving things as they are. you know, using.
What do you call that? Aesthetic acknowledgement?
I didn't call it that, but I like that.
With the basic acknowledgement.
Yeah,
leaving things as they are.
Yeah, but no, I like that. Thank you. I'm going to start using that. Yeah, unfortunately, I think it's a bit of a stereotype that indigenous people are all about the land. And one of the things that I also see, you know, is people dumping trash in areas that, you know, are of natural beauty. But the more traditional people still live a very simple, humble life, connected to the land. For example, I'm thinking of, there are two women, I guess the mother of the group doesn't still live in this way, but people have sheep camps and they will move their sheep from one camp to the other depending on where water is plentiful and vegetation is plentiful. But they live in structures made out of wood called hogans. They have an earthen floor and it's a one-room structure. But there are still a few people who live in this way, who choose to live without running water, without electricity, and to live off the land, basically. But that population is shrinking.
Is that the Bedouins?
Yeah, I think the Bedouins have really shrunk in terms of living like that. But it's still, I would say it still has a fairly nomadic property. But I was thinking about the Guarani Carlos and I visited in Argentina's area that was so of the earth. And I think there's still a lot of people who are living a traditional way. But they're probably the mid-generation of people. There's a lot of them, but the younger people are moving to the towns.
I
don't now. Understand this. It's also pretty invaded.
I'm trying to get my head in the right place.
Tourism,
but
other
I'm recognizing that I'm a lay person, and
things,
I
and they started having reservations a lot later, so the people didn't own anything.
I was having a conversation with Carlos as well. I've had three artists from Argentina come to the reservation to paint murals, and that was their observation that the indigenous culture in the States is very different from that in Argentina. There is still a lot more for additional.
Yeah, I think that's true. Although maybe there's more integration between things that are modern or like housing choices and things like that with a traditional way of living.
In Argentina.
Yeah, which I think is interesting. Somehow promote some possibilities or hope, because as we've invaded these places, there isn't really a whole opportunity. It's like a buffalo can't just roam around the earth anymore. So I think we have to deal with how people can have their traditions, their life, their ways, and still have everything that we've constructed.
One of the things that informs my art also is something I had an opportunity to witness that, what is the name of the man from India?
The Panther.
Yeah, he spoke to this. But within the Navajo traditional culture, there is ceremonies are still done using various colors of sand, and they're called sand paintings. And I guess different cultures do this. The people of Tibet also do it. But I had an opportunity. I had a patient, actually a two-year-old girl, who had a seizure, and it was what's called a febrile seizure, meaning she didn't have epilepsy, but because her fever rose quickly, her temperature rose quickly, she seized. And it's a disconcerting thing for a parent, you know, to see your child seizing. So the parents brought the child into the clinic. We evaluated the child and determined that there was an infection that was causing the fever to go up. We treated that and told the parents the child would be okay and wouldn't need to be placed on seizure medication. But the parents wanted more done. So they arranged for a sand painting ceremony to be done. And it was a really powerful thing. It occurred in the context of a hogan, which is a relatively small structure with an earthen floor. And I got there around 7 in the morning, and as I walked into the space, there was an older man, probably in his 70s, and his assistant, I think, was his daughter, who was probably in her 50s, and they were on their knees dropping sand onto a very intricate pattern. They were recreating deities within the culture, and they'd been working on this painting the entire night. And the little girl and her parents were off on the side, and the healer, the medicine person, sang a prayer, and then they told the parents to take the girl's diaper off and put her in the sand painting so he could finish singing the prayer. And as he was singing the prayer, you know, she was a 2-year-old girl in brightly colored sand who is now destroying his night of work. But it took me probably 19 years to really appreciate what I witnessed in that environment, in that my art project, for example, is paper placed outdoors on these structures, and they too are very ephemeral, but it's the intention with which it's done, you know, with love and humility and full sacrifice to create, again, kind of a space of healing and wellness. So that doesn't come so much from the land, but from the culture, from the community. Yeah.
But we're out of time.
Sand from the land. That's it. That's the
kind. Rural Louisiana is so different than rural Colorado.
That is community. In the sense that we talk about land, we've been talking about land in
a meeting today. And a friend of mine, one of my best friends, actually, is a filmmaker.
And you guys did one in Harlan too, didn't you?
We did one in Harlan. Yeah. Every single place. I did not realize how land and culture and place really informed.
I'm trying to figure out, like, you did one in what did you do?
Festivals. We did these.
Oh,
these,
you're part of this company?
No. It was a different organization. And we did festivals around the country that were kind of hyper-local, multidisciplinary cross-sector festivals that celebrated that place. And so we did them in Detroit and Appalachia.
Just like went in and tried to gather up all the community spirit. And
correct. I'm working with local artists and local women. I want to talk about that.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, it's
a whole other song that I know.
Great, I think that's a good spot.
Oh, yeah. So they had a meeting there, or?
No, I just, I work with a lot of, I used to work with a lot of
Are you moving in? Or do you need to be here? I can just sit on the bench, is that better?
All right.
I don't mind the bench. No, I like the bench.
What's your demand? All right, okay, without that, you can have that.
All right, y'all. Thank you for doing that. And I hope that was fruitful, what you heard. I'm going to lean into our facilitator, leader, folks. So I'll just be calling you. I'd love to go around, and I just want to hear one thing that was illuminated to you from that conversation we just had. And I might ask you a question about your own practice and work to let us hear a little bit more from you individually. And we're going to move this train to lunch. And I promise you, at 1:30, we will be moving to lunch. So I wanted to start with our friend Chip. Who I want to make the point that we are not as equipped to share right now. We are, but you know, it wasn't in this to be sharing a lot of images and a lot of digital material, but Chip's work is beautiful. And I would encourage you to go over to him in a break and just ask him, because he has a best hits folder He's got like a favorite hits. It's like, it's my favorite hits. So you don't even have to stay for long. You just get in, see it, see the thing, move on. But Chip, I just want to invite you to just offer something from your circle, the temperature of your conversation, something that was illuminated to you in there about this conversation.
Well, and I want to thank you for sharing what you did, because I appreciate that. I am a little out of context, out of place here. I am a visual artist, and I... don't necessarily come from a performing arts or theater background. So bear with me as I share this. I thought it was interesting in our group that people looked at the influence of land in just terms of taking time to be present in it, similar to taking the 2 minutes as we started this morning just to be in that space. One of the people commented on concentrated observation that comes from being outdoors and just noticing what's immediately in front of you. And we also looked at the impact, though, of our influence on the land, our relationship to it in terms of exploiting resources that the land might hold, and the response to that. People commented on nature, stimulating a radical imagination, again, from just observing and being present in it. And the appreciation of nature as one gets older. In our youth, we might not be as observant of the wonders of nature, but just as we age, appreciating some of the subtleties that we missed earlier. So,
thank you.
Yeah.
Kida.
One of the things that was, for me, came out of this conversation is the sense of spirituality connected to the land, but that we also hold that within ourselves, that most of us are not in those places that we are spiritually, familiarly connected to, and so holding that space within ourselves, regardless of the discomfort that it brings often of not being on stable ground, not allowing the land to hold you up, even though it is not comfortable, especially with people who are immigrants or people who are here. This is not a comfortable place always. And so how do you make that relationship? How the questions really were about how do you build that community and that relationship to the land so that you are more stable, so that you have hope going forward, so that you can be in a grounded place.
Carrie. Chair, pass.
I'd like to pause for a moment.
Yeah, I see that in your face.
Mm-hmm.
I would say that our conversation was had this really awesome stories about one, not feeling having roots in a place, and what does it feel like to be rootless, and how does that rootlessness also get mimicked in the way we have colonized land and the rootlessness of the colonizer, but also this real root you have when you meet land that you maybe didn't understand, and then you meet an ancestor, a father or a brother that it was part of that land, and how your personal relationship with another human can teach you to love some land through their history in their body of that land. And we talked about the very painful way in which sometimes it's hard to confront what we've done, a lot of people who have come to land and colonized land and brought that particular body to land, and how can we go back further and further to access a part in ourself that has a relationship to the land that isn't as painful or isn't as harmful or damaging. So those were some of the things we talked about, and we also reflected upon the wonder of paying attention and how many little lessons there are in being on the land and just quietly and subtly checking that stuff out and seeing if there's some wisdom in that for the way we do our work in the world.
Um,
Yeah, with my group's permission, I'd love to just share some snapshots without identifying. So, story circle as a way of witnessing stories and of developing material and images and phrases progressively. Freeing the ashes of my grandmother and ancestral place. Walking into space, hearing singing, realizing it's the way I want to live. I'm in the right place. Walking a mile out to a place that is normally underwater to immerse myself and be in a different environment, to fully be me, to fully be encompassed. Engaging with our waste as a daily practice. Immersing myself in the water, sinking knee deep into the mud to know that it's neither the mud nor the water. And what am I in that? The honoring and remembering of our seeds, of the sacred economy of our seeds, and the reverence of the seeds that maybe we've forgotten, but we bring back into place for banking for the future, a different kind of economy through the seeds. When I don't know what to do, I go to the lake, and it tells me what I need to do and gives me what I need. Journey into nature, following a guide, finding stillness and violence and transmission of knowledge. Those are the things that I'm taking away from our moment together. Thank you.
Our conversation was about a lot of things. One or a couple of things that really stood out is that we are the land wherever we are, and if we can occupy space, then that is our place. I'm paraphrasing there. The fear of land, that there are toxic situations, whether that be landmine or oil waste facility or, you know, you name it, there are dangers in the land in that relationship. And there's also systems that we were kind of talking about earlier in the day that have been put into place that are affecting those relationships that should be healthy but are not and are creating more disconnections. The responsibility of a place, even if you're quote unquote not necessarily from there, but if you're living in that place, then how you accept that responsibility and how you learn to love a place. Yeah, and that kind of goes back to you are of the place where you are, and how you can. Yeah, but I love that. Like, there was this occupying of people and a place, and the Occupy movement, civil rights movement actions, you know, where people are really holding space. I'm leaving out a lot, but also just how with the idea of sculpture, how you're not changing it but enhancing place. I don't think I'm saying it right. It felt kind of abstract when I was hearing it, but I understood it in the sense of like, yeah, to be someplace but to not change its definition. Just, yeah.
Thank you.
Matt? Yeah, hey, I'll break a protocol and ask everyone else who's in the group to help me as I meander through this a little bit. We had a really powerful conversation, and I think if we had like three or four more minutes, it would, you know, our rhythm of thought was really getting going. I think a couple of themes that I think were expressed across our conversation, I think, like, talked a lot about moving between places and moving between different identities in places. everything from moving to an urban to a rural area, and what are the implications for that for you as a person, for your practice, or the ethical implications of that. But also being in a place which in and of itself is in transition. And what does that mean oftentimes when artists are the drivers of that transition to one degree or another? That felt like a major thread in a lot of our stories. But also how to deal with our own personal histories in those places, and how do we deal with them over time as our relationship to those changes with our experience, and as our own experiences encompass more other folks' experiences. I think a big question that came out of the last couple minutes for our group was, like, what is within those two words themselves, land and narratives? And to what degree does that word narrative, since it comes first, does it almost precondition certain stories and certain responses to what is a really complicated set of relationships and circumstances? Those were just a couple of things, but I know there were others.
Yeah, we also talked about narratives, and we talked about language and dominion over the land, how the language, like, for instance, the word real estate, how that's a strange way of describing a place.
Mm-hmm.
We talked about connecting with nature with your hands, like even an urban environment, having what it means to have a community garden and be actually able to make something grow and watch it grow and eventually eat it, I guess. We talked about connecting to a place through history when it has been in your family for generations, and then what does it mean if that place is threatened by climate change? People in my group, do you want to help? Because I'm blanking about the rest.
That's great.
I think that was the gist of it. Yeah.
That's great.
Rather than explicitly share from our group, I'm just feeling moved to hold the space of silence for a bit. So I'm going to let you pick it back up when you'd like to, and just invite folks, if you'd like, to close your eyes or train your eyes on some part of the land, and open your ears and other types of awareness.
We have about a little bit of time before lunch, and I want to take...
Oh, can I just say, have those sounds been going the whole time?
Yeah. The cricket chorus?
Yeah. Turn that on.
I thought that was... You've got some speakers in the ground over here, don't you? It's all part of the performance. I have to say, one time I was here, I hope I'm not stepping out of line telling this story, but one of my deepest experiences of being here was one time coming here and realizing that they had trained some pigs for the Odyssey. Right. They were like pigs in the Odyssey. And then one time I came back and I was like, wow, this bacon is so good. And they're like, those are pigs from the Odyssey. Yeah. I talk about cycle of life, you know? It's like, you know, you use the things that are in the land and in the show, and y'all are truly doing it here. I'd love to just close this circle. I want to invite everyone who was individually part of this narrative to share a nugget of wisdom that you find through your work with the land or your engagement with the land in your work. And I'm going to introduce you all as we do this and invite you with some economy, given our time of 20 minutes, to just put one lesson you've learned, because I think that's nice to hear of the collective wisdom of the group. And maybe we'll just lean into these seven beautiful individuals here as we close the space. So I'm going to put you on the spot here, start with my man to the right. I'm really moved by this man's work in the world. His name is Robert Martin, as you know, and has for years been stewarding this piece of land in Kentucky. Hosts a very beautiful festival called the Clear Creek Festival, and an enormously powerful event called Land, Water, Food, Stories, and does excellent organizing in his community. He's a real teacher of mine. And I just would invite you to start by maybe offering a little lesson you learned from the land in your work.
I try to learn the lesson of getting out of my own way. I try to learn lifelong lesson of just deeper listening, picking yourself back up once the land squashes you, and realizing that you've just gained a lot of knowledge, and that, you know, like the lake, you just have to go out there and all the information is there if you can get out of your own way in order to listen. And it's can be deeply fearful. It can be those darkest places, but those are the places for me that I need to show up for in order to lean into my edge for the work. I need to constantly show up for that. It's vital, like the water that comes out of the mountain beside our home, and it's sustaining like the water that comes out of the mountain by our home. And it's necessary to know my relationship to that and to hold that with utmost reverence, like the water that comes out of the mountain beside my home. So that's what I can offer at this moment.
Perfectly modeled, Bob. Mm-hmm. Great timing. That was awesome. Monique Verdan, who some of you are going to get to know deeper here, she has this amazing film called My Louisiana Love, which you should see, and has been as tireless of an advocate about coastal land loss in the world as someone could be. Is just a really integral part of what's happening in Louisiana, and was using photography and filmmaking to tell our stories, and just a deep inspiration. So maybe you share a little wisdom with us.
I didn't share with my group that I'm working on a new project called the Land Memory Bank and Seed Exchange. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to come to terms with letting go of land, in that we are losing land at one of the fastest rates on the planet. And with that, what else are we losing? You know, our culture, our ways of life. I guess my lesson is that and we're talking about land, but I we're kind of like lowlanders, so wetlanders. You know, it's the water, as Bobby was saying, is, you know, we have the coast, we have the bayous, it's fresh, and it's that magical mix of fresh and salt there where so much life comes from. And I think that I've been the bearer of bad news for a really long time. I said this to my group, you know, the land is sinking, the water's rising, the oil is coming, you know, it's always that. But there also is this other layer, which is that the land and the water and the life is resilient and powerful and can heal itself if we allow it to do what it's supposed to do. So I'm trying to hold on to that like healing piece, and that to use my personal story and the stories that I know to raise that awareness of the importance of a place and how it's a microcosm for all of these other places. If my place is not healthy, you know, if we keep doing what we're doing in South Louisiana, the Arctic is going to have to deal with our side effects, and vice versa.
Our friend Chip, who I told you, go see the greatest hits folder right after we finish this, because it's beautiful. Chip, you want to share a little?
Yeah, so I apologize to the people who like moved because this is the story that I told at the very end. But as a physician, I had a 2-year-old patient on the reservation who had a seizure, and the parents took the child to see a medicine person to do a ceremony. The ceremony was a sand painting ceremony using sand that came from that area. And similar to the story you were telling this morning, I was invited into a ceremonial space called a hogan, which has an earthen floor. I arrived at 7 in the morning, and an older man and his daughter had been working all night on creating a very beautiful, intricate representation of a part of the cosmology for the Navajo people. And the ceremony then involved putting the 2-year-old girl in the middle of the sand painting, and a prayer then was sung for her while she was in the painting. But as she was sitting there, she started playing in the sand and destroying the pattern. And it took this older man and his daughter most of the night to create this, but the lesson that I learned from that was to create with good intention and with love, and then to let it go. And that's what I attempt to do in my work.
Mr. Matt, who many of you would know from reading his bio but might not know right now, has got a big old vision with a big project called Art of the Rural, which everyone should know about because it's a very big, expansive vision and organizing effort to bring together people who live in rural areas and are doing really amazing work.
Thanks. I kind of want to go back to something Chip said earlier, because we were kind of talking about this last night, like how grateful we are to be in a room with folks who are performing and who are thinking about theater, because like you all are so much more in touch with your body than creative writers. I don't want to make a generalization, but like, it's somewhat true, I think. You know, and I think that's really powerful because it gets to sort of what I have been thinking about. So a little bit about my story is I'm from southeastern Ohio. We have a farm that my family's lived on for 5 generations now. My parents had a separate farm that I was raised on, and we lost it during the farm crisis. So my experience as a kid, and really like a young adult up until very recently, was to feel sort of uprooted, which was something that came up in a lot of our stories too, and to feel in transition. And so I had this very, very complicated, emotionally complicated relationship to the place where I was born, which was, you know, I was there, I grew up there, my formative memories were there, but it was destroyed, it was strip mine, and was reclaimed, and the house for a while was there, it was at an angle, and it was a place which was both there and not there. And for a long time I had a lot of sort of very simplistic, moralistic readings of that situation, you know, and I think probably since I've started to Art the Rural and begun to hang out with folks like you all, I think I've begun to have a deeper understanding. And the tip, like a little tidbit, it's like a little card that I give out to folks when we talk about land, is there's a landscape writer named J.B. Jackson, and he says that landscape is a concrete, three-dimensional, shared reality. And when you're in a group of like landscape architects, like, oh yeah, it's like shared, like the economies are shared, and like transit, and this, that, and the other. But in this space, that word shared means something much bigger. And I've been really moved by hearing the ways in which that word shared gets to, I think, is a thing that like I have to deal with, and we all have to deal with in very different ways in our own context, which is to say like that land that I was on, like I share that with the person who destroyed it. You know, like we share that in some way. And I think the beauty of this dialogue is that being with you all in this space is takes me closer to that point of equanimity with that situation. So, yeah, I'm grateful.
Chantal, the great aggregator of people to come together to write about climate change that I know of, inviting artists to respond to the theater in the age of climate change. You can check out a lot of that writing through our friends at HowlRound, and has just been like tireless. Like, we're going to talk about climate change. We're going to talk about climate change, and it's so necessary and so awesome. So we should all check that out, and here you are.
So I would say that I feel the most alive when I'm in a place where I don't see any signs of human civilization. So in very remote places where the possibility of me dying are also very high. And this, I think it's two, there are two things about that. One is there's something primal, I think, to be reconnected with the fact that if you can't find food for yourself, if you can't navigate in the wild, or, you know, those basic instincts, and you have the possibility of encountering very dangerous animals, you're screwed. You know, you walk out wherever you are, and then it's all there for you to, for them to take you. And the other part of it is also, when I'm in a place like that, it reminds me of how small we are. Mm-hmm. And I find that very hopeful, because I feel like if we could all remember that in our daily lives, mm-hmm. we would do less harm. Mm-hmm. It's when we forget that part that we, and that we become arrogant, or we don't think about the consequences. But when you're reminded physically how small you are, it's just like, oh yeah, you know, I'm part of this bigger thing, and it's taking care of me, not the other way around. Mm-hmm.
Mm. Kida Kida, who calls herself a recovering environmental justice lawyer, who has managed to span a career of having a deep relationship to justice and social justice in the environment, and now such a perch to see so many artists doing their thing and supporting us in the way that she does.
One of the things throughout all these conversations, as we're talking about our relationship to the land, is I go back to the environmental justice definition of the environment, which is that place where we live, work, play. For some of us, it's pray. This is prayer around us. Go to school. So the land is what sustains us. The land is what keeps us surviving, but it is also the community that we are a part of. The land is actually a vital member of that community. And so as we as bipedal mammals need to remember that we are also part of the environment. And so that is part of how I go forward every day, is remembering what change I can do to make that community better. I am also a water person, and so to be near the water, it for me is always a source of strength and replenishment. And I realize that I'm not a person who looks at a glass as half empty or half full. I look at it as a vessel to be replenished. And that's where my relationship with the land, my relationship with my community, is that form of replenishment.
Carrie, you weren't feeling up to it earlier, so I want you to share that.
With your prompt being about lessons and insights,
yes.
I would actually invite people back into silence, but I'll say some things if you'd like me to say some
things. Okay, so I would like you to do whatever you want. But I just want to point towards this one thing that I think is so interesting about the relationship that Bob and Carrie have on the land that they work and steward on, is that they are simultaneously coming at this question of how to be with the land through the lens of art and organizing. Very deeply and very, very impressively, both. They both bring the full courage and strength and imagination of the art and the full wisdom of the organizing And I've watched, just in the little time that I've been around them, real change happen in their community because of this.
What's
and
Clear Creek like?
Yeah.
Yeah. Be.
In brief, what's, I don't know, Clear Creek, Kentucky?
It's in the foothills of East Kentucky, which is the western edge of the Appalachian Mountains. Old mountains. The place where we live is forested and wooded, predominated by oak trees, but dozens and dozens of beautiful deciduous species of trees. We live at one of the headwaters of Clear Creek, two or three beautiful mountain springs that flow from there. And what, speaking, Nick, to what you were identifying a bit, I think one of the things that I came to in the end of our story circle was this thought, you know, when I, Bob and I both are from Kentucky and grew up in Kentucky, and we went away for about a decade and came back, returned to Kentucky and found home again in Kentucky within the last 5 to 10 years. And many people in my organizing world, when I left to go live off grid, to go live in the woods, experienced that. I received the feedback of like leaving the movement or like having the privilege to go away and to escape something. And what I was really experiencing it as was like a returning to figuring out how to do the work in a more meaningful way to me that was not about a fight and a struggle and a this, but was to find a way to be in here. And I was reflecting on that as we were sharing this story circle, really reflecting on, I had a few years to start to gain that once we settled in Kentucky before a landman showed up about a year and a half ago, a landman, asking for the mineral rights on our land, on land that was coal land at one time. It was on the outskirts of coal land, and that now is at the far western edge of what the industry, the oil and gas industry, is calling the play of the Rogersville Shale.
Yeah.
And so I was very conscious in our circle toward the end of like, we don't escape the world as it, right? Like that landman literally drove up into our land way back off the road, right up to our doorstep and backed me up to our door to demand our mineral rights, right? And yet, because I had had the time and space to come to reconnect for the land, just to reorient myself just a few years, the way that I reacted and responded in that moment was so different than the way that I would have reacted and responded when I was living in another environment. And I still don't fully know how to express it, but it did come from a place of love. And also an engagement and an interaction that is a struggle. And so I'm holding both of those things in this conversation.
There's a great poet in New Orleans, his name is Moose Jackson. Taught me more about the land than anybody, probably. And he's a Detroit boy who somehow knows more about Louisiana than everybody else. And he always says, we are nature, Nick, and it is not our nature to destroy ourselves. And he wrote this beautiful poem, and I feel moved to share the words. It says, now at first I leaned back, half hid in those hairy cypress of almost human warmth and width. I take in the clicks and the grinding chirrups, surface sploosh, and zydeco rhythms drifting across the slough. The swamp don't just incorporate you, it becomes you. Breathes you, spooks you, unlocks and unfetters, loves your baser needs, your demise and your decay feed it. The more rotten, the more better, baby man. I love that little hero, how she sits so close to the water, gliding like a gator gone for a baby deer. The swamp is a creed. Purgatory of water,
a pilgrimage of land, a holy, immaculate afterbirth from a stillborn river. Swamp is me at my best, running wild through cypress and tupelo, nutri-rat and armadillo, crawfish and crabs, man, I live like a king. You let them fools tremble when they hear me sing. It's getting close to feeding time. Tonight, we party down in New Orleans.
I'd like to ask a question of a couple of people before we wrap up. Is that all right? Or do you want to? I'll respect if you would like to.
I would like to hold it because of lunch and the time.
All right. Sure.
But Matthew's coming to ask you the question right after this. Because it's 1:30. Facilitate his privilege. I'm taking it. DePonker, do you have the bells?
I gave it to Matthew.
Oh! Now we need Matthew.
I'm gonna get the bells out. And while I'm doing that, I'm gonna say something. Which is that, there's a lot of things about displacement and grief and uprootedness and longing and reverence and fear of change, destruction, and other things that have come up. And there's also some people here like Matt and Chantel and others who are very connected to lots of amazing models of innovation, of permaculture, of returning and trying new things. And I think this is a great space to find out more about those models and disseminate them. I for one, would like to hear about them, and I think others do too.
1 minute of silence to close it out. Thank you for your attention, for all the stories and all the good comments and feedback. If there are lunch logistics, may they be now.
We have about 5 to 10 minutes to stretch lunch.